So welcome to this last session. I have the privilege of introducing two more of my colleagues who have been participating or who will be participating in the MOOCs activities from IIT Bombay side. Yesterday you heard Professor Gaitonde and Professor Milind Atre. We have two more colleagues, may I invite them here, Professor Vikram Gadre and Professor Supratik Chakravarti. So as I told you, Professor Supratik Chakravarti is I am his co-instructor in CS101X and I am also his co-instructor in CS101, which as I told you is being offered in blended mode in IIT Bombay itself. And both of us are doing this for the first time. We have taught umpteen courses all our lives, but never in this fashion. And maybe you can share for 5 minutes something what you went through. Professor Vikram Gadre is, Professor Supratik is my colleague in computer science department. Professor Vikram Gadre is a professor in electrical engineering department. He is also currently the head of our Center for Distance Engineering Education Program. In fact, this particular seminar hall in which you are sitting technically is under CDIP control, so we are actually his guests here. Needless to say, both of them are very well renowned researchers in their own areas. As students, both of them excelled in their batches. Professor Supratik was the President of India gold medalist from IIT Kharagpur, and then he did his PhD from Stanford. Professor Vikram Gadre was President of India gold medalist from IIT Delhi, and he decided to continue doing his research there itself. So he finished his PhD from IIT Delhi, but thankfully joined us, both of them. And they have been here for many, many years. We are lucky that many people, as Professor Gaitonde was mentioning, are increasingly becoming enthusiastic to join us. There's a younger colleague of ours who could not come for some reason, Professor Kameshwari Chebrolu. She is from the computer science department, and before the MOOCs platform started making inroads, she had embarked on a development work on a platform for the online kind of thing, which is actually designed for the blended mode thing. It is called Bodhi Tree. This particular platform was used by us in one of the 10,000 teachers workshops on computer networks. So where teachers participated online using that thing, and then in a face-to-face mode. We have decided that in our platform development work, we will take the best features from Bodhi Tree as well in this. She is not here. She also has the distinction of winning the coveted Excellence in Teaching Award of the Institute at a very young age. These awards, by the way, are all given based on the students' feedback. There is no evaluation by faculty or something, so students evaluate. Professor Gadre, by the way, routinely gets that award. Routinely in the sense that we have a moratorium of 3 years. So if you get an award for next 3 years, you cannot get. The moment 3 years pass, he gets it again. So this is what you got it third or fifth time or something, fourth time, right. So we are very fortunate that not only people who are passionate but who are known to be great teachers, apart from being great researchers, are available. I would request both of them to share with you their experiences, experiments, and their own expectations. Please understand that in the MOOCs game, they are ahead of you only by a few months. So they are as good as all of us here. So the same trepidation whether this will work or not, etc., etc., must have crossed their mind. But as I said, they dared, as all of you are going to dare. So, Supratik, next.
You know, this is the first time I'm teaching such a large student body. In the CS101.x that we are offering on edX, there are around 60,000 students enrolled. And at IIT Bombay, we are teaching it to around 570 students. Some of the things that I had to learn the hard way is different when you teach to to students in an online mode as opposed to a physical classroom interaction teaching is that when you're, I mean, one of the things that I'm still struggling with is, so we have this 15-minute sort of kind of hard deadline. Every lecture has to be broken up into 15-minute modules. And I mean, initially I thought it's a big deal, you know, I'll just take my lecture and cut it up into 15-minute modules. And it turns out that it's not so easy actually to do that. And as a consequence, what has happened is that I've had to take several retakes. So I start recording my lecture and then in whatever, you know, full flow, full passion, I'm explaining something and I think I've done it in 15 minutes and then the recording team tells me it has gone to 18 minutes. And even with all the editing and all, they cannot bring it down to 15 minutes. So what you have to do is you have to re-record the whole thing again. So I think this is, I mean, it is important because that, I mean, I think pedagogic studies basically say that students' interest span doesn't last for more than 15 minutes. So it's a new form of, it's a new mode of teaching. I'm not used to it. I'm learning it the hard way by doing lots of retakes. But I think that, you know, at the end of the day, when I see the lecture videos, which are 15 minutes each, you know, one might just think that, oh, it's just 15 minutes he spoke. But there's actually a lot of preparation that goes on behind it. So I will tell you the estimates, I mean, just to sort of, you know, make all of you aware of the amount of effort that goes into one 15-minute lecture module that comes up there. So my track record, maybe I'm particularly bad at that, is that I have been taking around 1 hour and 15 minutes to prepare the slides for a 15-minute lecture. And this is because if I'm trying to say something substantial within those 15 minutes, I have to put in animations, I have to create appropriate illustrations, and all of this eventually has to be open source. So you have to basically create all of this content. So my average is I require 1 hour, 15 minutes to 1.5 hours to prepare the slides for a 15-minute lecture. And then as I'm trying to give the lecture, almost 50% of the time I have to do a retake. So it's really more like 2 hours goes on behind preparing what finally shows up there as a 15-minute lecture. So it is, I mean, it might appear to be a lot of work, and it is indeed a lot of work, but I think the end result is worth it. So when I look back at the lectures and see what has gone into it, what is finally being delivered there, I think it is worth it. And certainly for the students, I hope and believe that it will be worth looking at those lectures. So I just wanted to say that you need to be aware of this, that it, as opposed to a normal classroom lecture where, you know, if you exceed from a 50-minute lecture to a 52-minute lecture, nothing much happens, right? I mean, you're in a class, you're lecturing, it's a, let's say, 50-minute lecture slot, and if you exceed to 52, 53 minutes, nothing much happens. You don't have to retake the lecture. You don't have to start all over afresh. But here you have to, I mean, because, you know, there are some hard deadlines. And so it requires a lot of planning. I think it requires very meticulous planning about what exactly you're going to speak, how you're going to cover. And maybe now I appreciate a little bit why film actors get paid that much. So it is a new experience. The other lesson that I've sort of started learning the hard way is the way you evaluate students is very different. When you're teaching to 60,000 students, you cannot conduct a normal conventional examination. So it has to be, I mean, for example, Professor Fatek and I are teaching programming, right? And so we have to ask these students to write programs. But, I mean, we are still in the process of developing an autograder. I mean, forget about grading it manually. So it has to be graded automatically. But the moment you say that it has to be graded automatically, it puts some constraints on the kinds of questions you can set. It puts some constraints on what you can evaluate through those questions. And these are normally not there in a regular classroom examination mode. So, you know, when we write a question, I mean, this is going online, right? So if I set a question and this happens oftentimes in an examination hall that some student says, you know, but this wording is not clear, so what exactly do you mean? So you can walk up to that student and say, okay, this is what this means. Here there is no scope of doing that, right? I mean, you put up your questions, it goes online, 60,000 students are seeing it, and now you can't start explaining. So you have to be that ultra careful to make sure that whatever you're writing in English has, there's just one way of interpreting that. I mean, nobody from whatever culture, this also, people from different cultures are reading that. So, you know, preparing exam questions itself also takes a little bit more caution, care. And then, I mean, we have both Professor Fatak and I mean, of course, Professor Fatak has a lot more experience in teaching than me. We are realizing that it is next to impossible to come up with a question paper in which none of the 60,000 students will find a fault. So this is our goal, but we have not succeeded so far. In all the tests that we have given, no matter how much preparation we have put in, at least one error has surfaced up somewhere, and
there are at least 20 people who point that out.
Yeah, I mean, out of 60,000 students, there will be 20 people pointing out, and so, but we are learning. Hopefully the next offering of the course on Swayam, at least whatever is going to be offered, will, you know, take the lessons we learned from edX and we'll implement those. This is what I would like to emphasize, that both teaching and evaluation are not the same as it is in a normal classroom. I think all of us are used to normal classroom mode teaching, normal exam mode evaluation, but here it is different, and I guess this is the way of the future. I mean, in the future, classes will be offered online, exams will be conducted online if you want to reach out to large numbers of students. But this does require reorienting ourselves. The other aspect which Professor Fatak might have already mentioned is that it also requires a very strong and dedicated force behind you. I mean, you know, I can probably teach a class of 200 students all on my own. I mean, if I'm willing to spend some time, I'll probably be able to correct all of their papers myself and all. But here, it requires a dedicated force behind you. I mean, starting from the, you know, media team, which does all the recording, editing, transcription, from the team which actually goes and looks at the questions and tries to figure out whether there are any ways to interpret them in multiple ways. Could there be some other way of answering the question? So it requires a trained force. I mean, not only do we as teachers have to train ourselves, I think our support staff, teaching assistants, all of them have to be trained. And I think Swayam would be a great platform to go ahead with that. Yeah.
The question would have been like, it's a kind of an irrelevant question, but I'll ask it anyway. The kind of queries that you get in a live class vis-a-vis the kind of discussion forums that are raised here, are they different?
I can answer,
yeah,
this.
Please, you can answer.
Yes, I have taught this course for donkey's years. This is my most favorite course. It is not the first, but the second course I taught in 1973. And since then, with great regularity, I have been teaching.
I took it in Kolkata.
Oh, you did, I see. Oh, when you were a student. It was quite some time ago, remember? So I will tell you something. So actually, yes, the queries that are asked by our students are similar queries are asked by two very important points. This is what we were afraid of, that when the number of students increase, whether the number of queries will increase exponentially, they don't. The second important point that we notice is that just as among students, sometimes they themselves tell their colleagues what the answer is. But that does not happen so well in a classroom environment, because they want to come and always ask the teacher. Here on the forum, a large number of questions are being answered by a number of people. In fact, if you see the discussion forum for a large course, that discussion forum itself contains gems of wisdom about that course. Various people commenting on this aspect and that. So that is what we have noticed. And questions are very similar. In fact, sometimes very intelligent observations are made by some people, which even our students in IIT miss. But a number of them are also very mundane and very bogus kind of questions. It is not uncommon, by the way, to find somebody saying, "Arey Lallu, why don't you read that?" In English, of course. So, So the other people will advise, you are confused because you have not read this, you have not read that. It's a very interesting bag.
Maybe I have the terminology wrong, but there's something which you call a blended course and a flip course. Are they the same thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
So when we say blended, what it means is that it combines online and face to face.
Okay.
And the way we blend it is that in the blended mode, the online portion still remains. That means students watch the course videos, students do the practice problems, students do the quizzes online. But they come to the classroom where the entire lecture session is devoted to discussions and problem solving.
Okay, so if so, I think I've got the idea right.
So it is the flipped classroom.
Right. So the so my question begins now. In that mode, in the blended mode or in the flip mode, do you think that the overall teaching or learning experience is better than the normal classroom?
Much better. In fact, the participation by the students in problem solving, in discussions amongst themselves. We also use a methodology called think, pair, share, where Supratik has modified it to say not pair, but a group. So we have groups of 13, 14 students who sit together. So after a question is answered individually, then they discuss. And what he and I do is we'll walk up to some people, randomly pick out a answer book where they are writing the solution. And that is not only quiz A, B, C, D kind of. They have to write maybe program
longer answers.
And we'll get those program segments to the front of the classroom and display that to the entire class.
Okay.
And that way, I will tell you, in fact, Professor Sridhar Iyer, my colleague, actually did a controlled experiment last year when he taught CS 101 in a flipped classroom scenario. Kameshwari has done the same thing for the network course. Sridhar Iyer's finding is that the students' engagement, as opposed to teachers' engagement, teacher will whatever, students' engagement, which on an average hovered around 40% in the normal course delivery. That means only 40% of the students, or all students 40% of the time, are engaged. Otherwise, they may be attending a class apparently, but they are not necessarily listening to you, or they are not doing it. Here, they have proven by actual experiment that the engagement goes as high as 80%.
So, is there a flip side?
The flip side is that can the flipped classroom be extended to 60,000 students? I had promised that I will circulate my invited paper, I will do that. That is where I have argued that the best way to use a blended mode is that, let us say, ICER Pune offers a course on physics. Okay. Now that course is adopted as a blended MOOC course by 1,000 institutions in the country. All those students attend online classes of yours, give online exams. But during the regular lecture hours, the teachers engage with them on the flipped classroom mode. They solve their problems, they solve problems, they have discussions. I even suggested that online examinations should amount to about 80% of the total credit grade, and 20% of the grade should come from the local teacher who gives them long assignments, essay type assignments, gives a mini project for the course and evaluates that course there locally. So this is the model which actually we are doing now. For example, we have TAs in a programming course, people have to write programs. So they write programs and submit them in the labs. Those are evaluated by TAs. They do a course project, which are evaluated by us and TA, and there will be marks for that portion in addition to the online equivalent. I personally believe that that may be the ideal model where students get the best of both the things. That may take some time. In fact, this year, there were at least 10 autonomous institutions and some universities who were willing to experiment. They were waiting for me to announce CS101 in this mode. But we said we'll first experiment with our own students and then extend. But this is a model which is likely to spread quite fast, because then those universities and those autonomous institutions will accept the MOOC grade. There's one more advantage is weekly online examinations will be proctored by the local teachers in their own college. So there is a sanctity for online exam, sanctity for a grade. That is the next step.
So So you're asking, is there a flip side to this?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm new to this, but I think, as Professor Fatak said, that I think the blended model, I mean, if you just say, see the lectures at home and that's it, you know, I mean, we'll just solve problems in class. Because sometimes some students, see, in a normal classroom, what happens is that, let us say I plan to, let's say I've come to class and I have planned that I'm going to teach topics A, B, C in today's class. But while teaching, let's say in the middle of topic B, I realize that a lot of students have some questions, and maybe at the end of the class, I end up only teaching topics A and B, right? Whereas here, what's happening is we are telling them beforehand that look up the lectures for A, B, C, and we'll come to the class and do that. Right. Now, while looking up the lectures for A, B, C, it is perfectly possible that some of the students, or maybe a large number of the students, I mean, I'm trying my best when I'm giving the lecture, but it's in front of the camera. Correct. It's not in front of students, right? So I might have misjudged on what I should have stressed more or stressed less. And so when the students are coming to class, maybe they've tried to see all the lectures on A, B, C, but maybe they didn't understand much of B, and therefore they didn't understand much of C. Now, if we just say that, okay, A, B, C is done, you should have seen, and now we are going to just solve problems on A, B, C, and next day, please read up, please look up the videos for D, E, F, then there is a problem, right? Yeah, so therefore, in the class, I mean, this is what we have also learned. And we have we actually figured out that in the class, there are some students who are lagging behind because they didn't understand some of the lectures, which we had put up some 2 weeks back.
Okay. Right.
And then we realized that maybe, you know, we need to do these revision sessions in class. So I think what is important is put the lectures up there, let the students see them maybe once, twice, thrice, as much as is needed. But give also them the control to decide the pace of the class, about how fast topics are going to be covered in the class. If you just say, you know, I decide how fast the class goes and we'll just discuss problems and whatever is done in a day. So it has to be blended.
The thing is that if B is not understood,
yeah,
then you should be able to give a break in your course schedule and start the E part 1 week later instead of.
So I'll tell you, this actually happened.
Yeah, that's
right. In a particular class, which was recorded 2 weeks before when we actually asked the students to give. So we recorded it, we thought we have covered everything, and then when we went to the class, we realized that there is a lot of problem. And so I went back and re-recorded something, some additional material, and then we put up that. We gave some handouts. And so because this is feedback coming from the class, that whatever was there in the lecture, I mean, although it is correct, it is right, but it wasn't sufficient for them. So these additional mechanisms must be there to sort of insert extra material, give more elaborations. I mean, so there is this module of 15-minute lectures which covers the whole course, but these additional things, I think, are absolutely essential, and these are sort of governed by the feedback from the class. Particularly the weaker students.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, in a large class, you know, if you take the percentage as more or less fixed, there will be a large number of weaker students. And the weaker students may not feel, you know, I mean, they may not feel up to like raising their hand in the class and saying that, you know, I did not understand those three lectures. So I think there, as teachers, it is our responsibility to gauge the pulse of the class and to figure out that, okay, maybe we have gone too fast, and stop it there and say, okay. I mean, that's what Professor Fatak and I were forced to do.
Correct.
So we said that, okay, now in these 2 weeks, no further lectures.
Correct.
There is no new material.
No.
So we just did revision of all of those.
How did you get the feedback that, I mean,
you see the students, no, they are not able to solve the problems.
No, but it's a live class.
Yeah.
Had it been a completely pure MOOC kind of class,
I will answer
what comments?
We propose to do something very similar for the online course as well, which we'll experiment with Swayam and with the new EDX thing, whatever. The decision is as follows. The decision is that we will stick to this model, but just as what we are doing in CS101 Live, what we are doing is, I am taking one or two problems whose solution will explain certain concept better, and I am actually giving a lecture. So for 45 minutes, I am explaining just two problems which explain some concept better. And the feedback from the faces and from their immediate question that I ask is that they have understood better. Now, what I have decided is, even on the MOOC site, whenever there are feedback, because there are feedback in multiple ways. Quiz is not answered correctly by many people is one feedback. What we have decided is we will do exactly the same thing. We will record additional 40-minute, 45-minute lecture, 30-minute lecture, 1-hour lectures if required, explaining certain concepts more in a more elaborate fashion, taking some examples and working them out, and put those videos as additional material. So the better students may not need those, but the other students may benefit from them. Sorry?
So there is this flip side of MOOC which I have sensed in one of the ordinary engineering colleges, which I would like to share with the audience.
Yeah.
Firstly, I mean, with all that we have heard till now, we are putting a lot of onus on the student now. On one side, we say it's a learner-centering education, but that means we expect certain motivation level from the student to see all these videos before actually they come to the next class.
Yes.
I went to a small town engineering college, I won't name it, with this thing that I talked to the students, and they have come from the lower cutoff kind of category. So they are not very good students. They said, we don't like this because we pay fees and we expect students to teach us. We want to be spoon-fed. I'm just sharing this with the audience.
So I think this is an issue for which we have to evolve. So either the complete online thing is not the solution for this, but at the same time, just the classroom level thing cannot scale up. Right? So I think there is a middle ground somewhere in between.
That's right.
And particularly, I mean, unless the students have some say in how the pace of the course is going to go and what topics need more stress, I mean, I might feel, even with, you know, whatever experience I have, that this topic needs more explanation. But in a particular year, maybe the other topic needs more explanation. So this is something that has to go on as the course is going. So we have some material, but then in a particular year, maybe this needed more explanation, and another year that needed. So that interaction feedback, which comes automatically in a normal classroom, I think we have to very consciously build that in over here, because otherwise there will be a part of the
student. Considering that we will be working only on MOOCs for quite some time, let's restrict our restriction to MOOCs rather than blended MOOCs. But Professor Verma had one observation.
No, but my comment is relates not to MOOCs, but to the blended classroom that you were talking about. I sat through actually a class here at IIT Bombay taken by Kannan.
Yes.
And the thing that I really liked when we were talking about feedback, all classrooms here are Wi-Fi enabled.
Yes.
Kannan, like you know, had distributed the Akash tablets with clicker on it. And so he had given his videos out. Students saw those videos, came to class. As soon as they came to class, he gave a quiz. And based on the answers of the quiz, he knew immediately, because the answers were collated immediately.
What needs to be covered.
He knew immediately what he has to cover.
We are doing precisely that.
Exactly. That's the
point. We are doing at the beginning of the class.
Yes.
We are conducting a quiz.
Yes.
And we get to see those answers.
The instant feedback.
Yeah.
That is the key.
Unfortunately, we did not use Akash tablets in the class, because when I have 250 students in a batch, the Wi-Fi breaks down. But we'll do something. Let us now listen to some comments from Professor Gadre.
I, of course, am in a few phases behind Professor Vatak and, you know, Professor Suprati, because I am just in the phase where I'm recording the lectures at the moment. But still, there are many educative experiences I've had. Well, as Suprati also said, this is you don't require to reorient yourself in terms of how you plan for each, I mean, I call it a session, you know, we can call it anything, but I call it session. So what I've done is, you know, I'm going to create a course on signals and systems. So signals and systems is a course which I think some of you may be aware, it's also a very fundamental course in electrical engineering. In fact, it also happens to be a fundamental course in most disciplines of engineering where they talk of system level development, I mean, you know, system theory, I'm saying. Control systems, or of course in electrical engineering it is a foundation for communication systems, for anything to do with mobile communication or wireless communication or control systems, or system design, system theory, this kind of a course is required. So that is the background of the course that I'm creating. It's called Signals and Systems. Now, there were several decisions to be taken when I started creating the course. One is, should we think of this as one course as we do at IIT Bombay, for example, or a semester-long course? And the decision I took was not to do that after consulting Professor Vatak, of course, and some of his staff. I decided that we should break the course up into two courses. And if I'm not mistaken, that's also being done in computer for the CES 101. It's being broken into two courses. Well, roughly speaking, in the IIT sense, it might be what you would cover up to the mid-semester examination and what is covered beyond the mid-semester examination. And in fact, in the course that I'm creating on signals and systems, this also happens to be a natural break, because there is something that, you know, you need to teach up to the mid-semester examination, and then the concepts that follow after the mid-semester examination are naturally a little more advanced. So it was also fortunate that this was a natural break, and roughly half and half get covered in or get talked about in these two parts. What I've also done is to break each part into two modules, because that's also a natural break. There are four aspects to this course in my view. I mean, people may have different views, but in my view, there are four aspects which are roughly 1/4 of the course, and the first two aspects take up the first course, you may call it, and the second two aspects take up the second. So this is how I'm just sharing with you how I've kind of sort of planned my course. Now, I'm yet at the phase where I'm creating the what I call embellishments to each of the sessions. But I could share with you in a course like, well, here, this course requires a lot of what you might call derivation, you know, in the sense, different courses have different characters. Now, this is a course where you actually need, it has a lot of concepts and a lot of mathematical ideas. And what I decided is, perhaps akin to what I do in a classroom traditionally, I'm going to ask the student to, in some sense, work with me. So I have used what I call the extension of the chalk and talk, but you can't actually do that here. But I'm using the framework where I actually write down a derivation in a certain way and I speak along with it. So it's almost as if I was standing in a classroom facing students and doing a derivation in front of them. I did not prefer to use the slide model because it just, I mean, to me, it did not make sense for derivation. Somehow, I mean, it's a personal, people can do it. I mean, it's not that can't be done. But I found it much easier and much more meaningful to actually write down the derivations step by step and sort of ask the student to work with me. And I'm hoping that that goes well. Let's see how it goes. Now, a few things that I want to share with you here. In fact, I agree. Now, I probably will really experience this issue about 15 minutes and 18 minutes. And to some extent, I've experienced that already. But it will also come up when this course is actually delivered. You know, how whether we have done justice in 15 minutes, have we gone too fast? These are issues which I don't know at the moment, because I'm just creating them based on what I think is reasonable for one session and so on. You know, but that issue will come up. But more importantly, what I also realized is that it's very important within that 15 or 18 minute, I mean, 18 minutes of recording, that comes down to 50, that's what I've understood, because in my case, it's a lot of writing, so that gets cut. So what is very important is also to round off an idea. Now, you know, for example, sometimes a derivation can be quite involved. You know, you have to decide whether you should complete that derivation in that one session, or you then break the derivation up reasonably into two sessions. You know, this is a very, I mean, for, see, otherwise in a 1 hour classroom, you, if it's an involved derivation, you can take the whole hour and do the derivation. Here, you have to take a conscious decision. You don't have an hour, and you do have to convey that idea. So you really have to take a conscious decision on, you know, whether you should break the derivation into parts, or whether you should give a sense of the derivation in one module and then break it, you know, then explain. So I'm just sharing with you some of the things that I've encountered so far. Otherwise, I mean, as I said, I'm a few phases behind because I'm still creating the material. And I also welcome questions or inputs from you on what you think. If some of you know about the core signals and systems, I would welcome inputs, because I'm keen to have this course started particularly, I believe this is for an Indian audience also, no? So for the Indian audience, I would like this course started as soon as possible. I mean, maybe if possible in December itself. So, you know, these are a few words from me.
I'm very glad to announce that apart from the two courses which will be announced by IIT Bombay, both of which will start from 2nd October, we're giving a 1 week period. Any of you who believe that their course can be ready or whatever it is, the earliest start date is 2nd October because we need to advertise to the students to register. As Mr. Praveen Prakash had told you, the start date could be anywhere from 2nd October up to next February or March. So depending upon how much time you decide. But the third course that will be offered, on offer at least from IIT Bombay, will Professor Vikram Gadre's course. I am still trying to convince Professor Kameshwari to give her course, but she may or may not be ready. There is one more course I am announcing, and I will be requesting Professor Parshuraman to take the lead. Anybody from TIS? So this is, if you recall, yesterday we talked about a course on Blender with the intention of training people as a vocational training for animation and for educational animations. So is Samir here? Yeah. So I'll be writing to Professor Parshuraman. I would like TIS to take a lead. IIT Bombay can also take a lead, but logically, the what you call vocational kind of thing is best done by TIS. What do you say, Professor Pradeepan? So our team can, of course, support you. You have worked here. I will tell you why I am keen on this, because one of the objectives of the entire national mission on education through ICT is to expand this higher education segment initiatives to high school education and vocational training. And vocational training is actually perceived as the greatest need of the country today. There is a large number of people who need to be trained for getting jobs and so on. So that is why if we have at least one course on vocational training made available immediately, then it will give a flavor that yes, this SWAYAM platform is like this. There is another thing which I don't know whether I mentioned on that there is an initiative to start this kind of MOOCs for high school students, including not necessarily Akash, but a low cost tablet or a low cost access device, and even hardware experiments on those devices for the science students. A lot of interesting things are happening here. I would request Professor Gadre to do one more small pleasant duty. We have a tradition of distributing course certificates for every workshop. So we have these certificates here. As head of our, incidentally, in IIT Bombay, operationally, all online and distance courses, including our MOOCs operations, including our EDX MOOCs participation, are operationally controlled by head CD. So in some sense, he is my boss. So may I request Professor Sanjay Kumar? Nageshwar?
Thank you.
Dr. Shatrudha? Dr. Jyotsna Dixit? It is not well known, but many, many years ago, perhaps more than a decade ago, or more than a decade ago, 13 years ago, Jyotsna used to be a staff member on one of my projects, like Virunda is today. So Virunda, I can see you as Dr. Vrinda sometimes 10 years later. Yes.
Thank you.
Arindam Bhattacharya. Professor Manju Jaiswal.
Thank you, Manju.
Professor Pritam Basu. So have you decided on which management courses, etc.? The one which you presented, that itself will expand or what?
Don't know.
Maybe some. Dr. Bhas Bapat, and one of his colleagues was a student here, a BTech from IIT.
Yes.
Anirban Hazra, Dr. Anirban Hazra. Yes. I sir had a very great combination of faculty members. He is the coordinator, he attended all the 3 days. One of the lead faculties attended the first day, and another lead faculty was supposed to attend the third day, but he didn't come at all. Mr. Saurabh Bhutolia. Dr. Jaikishan. Dr. R.K. Vyas.
Thank you.
Professor Mohammad Kasim.
Thank you, Professor.
Professor F.B. Khan.
Thank you.
Dr. Kusuma, he is also from Jamia Millia.
Thank you.
Ms. Sanjeev Kumar.
He's from JNU. Thank you.
Dr. C. Ramakrishna. He's from NITTR, Chandigarh.
And his colleague. Thank you.
And Pradeep Kumar.
Thank you.
Paramjit Singh. So, did you enjoy Paramjit?
Yes, good.
Dr. Madhushri Shekhar.
Thank you. Thank you.
Samir Sahasrabuddhe.
Thank you.
You see, he was the one who created the entire audio-visual setup for our online education in 2000-2002 when he came here. We had nothing. We started synchronous distance education essentially with him. Mr. Vihan Pandey.
Thank you.
Professor Atul Negi. Professor Ramakrishna, he actually made it a point to appoint him as a coordinator and send him immediately at a very short notice. Dr. S. N. Oja. So he wants to know, because the tradition is to have classes under a banyan tree.
Oh, yeah.
So how the cloud can be kept under a banyan tree is his question.
You know, I forgot to share one thought which I had in the creation of this course with all of you, and that is, I want to replicate, since you know he talked about Vishwa, so I want to replicate the idea of the Upanishads in this course. You see, the Upanishadic style, I call it, essentially, where you have a teacher sitting with students around, and you know, Upanishad, some people interpret it essentially as sitting near. So the idea is, you know, when a student just sits next to a teacher and asks, he learns more than trying to read a book, or you know, so that's the thought in the Upan. Now what I'm thinking is, in this kind of a course, one very good way to do it is encourage students to ask questions and record them, and have a system by which, you know, one can actually give those interactions as a part of the course material. So I'm planning that in the Signals and Systems course. I call it the Upanishadic style.
I would like to use the remaining 10-15 minutes to collect some reactions from you on two topics. One, the general comments on this initiative, and if you feel that there could be some tweaking or modification that could be done for the strategy. And second, about this workshop itself, what has been your experience?
Just like comment on this Upanishad part. So in Department of Physics, PHU, we are running a discussion forum which is called PLUT, P-L-U-T. And the full form is Physics Learning Through the Upanishad Trend.
Oh.
So it is already going on. We have a group of 30 students. And 3-4 teachers used to sit, questions from the students, and we just discuss. It is not pre-decided, and the tradition goes on this way. The second thing which is slightly means, of course, I like the workshop very much. I was a little bit curiosity. Suppose, means from BHO side, if suppose two of my colleagues wants to float this course within a month or so, is it possible that I can send him here, because you have the infrastructure, they can record in a 2 months or 1.5 month time the full lectures. Is it possible?
You're asking a very difficult question. I will first answer my difficult part and then tell you their difficult part. Our difficult part is that while our team, as you have seen, is extremely dedicated and competent, but we have lined up activities. In fact, most of Sajjan's team, for example, ends up working on all Saturday, Sunday, and Vrinda's team also ends up working on all Saturday, Sunday. That is the current load. But I will tell you, practically, it is not very easy to do so. You see, our recruitment cycle, we also have the same problems as yours. We have to advertise, we have to wait for scrutiny, we have to conduct tests, our tests are very rigorous, and then we interview them, and then they take their own joining time. So it is 2 to 3 months before we can get new staff. Now, we have an additional dilemma. My advertisement cannot be released unless the number of people that I am asking for are as per some sanction letter of the project. And money is there. Without money, no appointment letter is issued, because the salary has to come from real money, not from hypothetical. Today the ministry has said go ahead without any money. They have said go ahead without any formal sanction letter. The letter says the process of approval is on, but you are requested to start the activities. Now, our dean is considered and we have started this activity, but it will be some time before we can spruce up our people. What I can do best is, if you have any staff members, technical staff members, does not matter if they are working in some other area. Okay. Let me tell you, for example, Sajjan, who leads my entire video team, is professionally a programmer. He is not a video person. It was Samir Sastrabuddhe who converted him into a top class video person. In turn, he has taught people. Sushant, who is his second in command now, ask him what he was when he came here. All of them have learnt on the job, and we pride ourselves in having luckily an environment where people who come in may not know absolutely anything about what they want to do, what they have to do, but they pick up very quickly, and the environment is so conducive. Ask Jyotsna what she knew when she came here as a project employee. Now, this is also your responsibility to try and build that kind of thing, nurturing people. Without it, it would be difficult. My request would be that you please wait for hiring your people, or if you have existing people, what I can promise is we will do a very good job of conducting a training workshop for such technical people, whether it is video, whether it is Vrinda-like thing, and so on and so forth. And as I promised, they will be lectured not by me and Professor Supratik and Professor Gadre, but by Sajjan, by Sushant, by Vrinda, by Kalpana, by Mukta. If there is a coordinator at your end who handles logistics, Mukta's team can train them to handle logistics in 2 days by simply making them handle logistics here. You have seen our style of training. You just do the work.
On the behalf of the participant, I propose a vote of thanks for you, sir, and for your team member. A huge round of applause for your team member. Thank you very much. We have a very good stay over here, and we have learned a lot. Thank you for taking back a lot of things.
I am thankful that you say that, because I have always maintained that great jobs are accomplished not just on the strength of funding, not on the strength of infrastructure and equipment, but they are accomplished by people. And as you have seen, our team, I mean, can you imagine, I can't imagine any other place in this country, including very competent institutions like ours, who are told that in 4 days' time, you have to conduct a training workshop. And in 4 days' time, with whatever they could organize that much. I'm really proud of it. I would like to thank also my own workshop team. I think they've done an absolutely marvelous job. Same thing is true about everybody else. Vrinda and Urmila, who have spent considerable amount of time with you, they have to make up for it by working late in the night and on Saturdays and Sundays to cover up the transcription and uploading of the recordings which people like Supratik, Fatak and Vikram Gadre will be giving them. Because that pipeline goes on. There is a deadline for that. So everybody is able to do that, and I'm very happy about it. I'm happy that you liked it. So thank you.
Sir, I will add on it ki on the day one when we landed here, we were really reluctant to, and we were thinking that such an heterogeneous group, when sitting together, what they will carry after 3 days.
Yeah.
But on the last day, when I see, I think all of us has really not only gathered the technical part of the orientation program, but the motivation which you have given to us to work at our own institution, that is just add and color to this orientation program. And as Dr. Jayakrishnan says, it's really thankful to you and obviously our great persons sitting at the back.
Yes.
Who has really helped us till late nights whenever we have called them. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
So first of all, thanks to the entire team for doing this wonderful job of guiding us through these 3 days of learning through the MOOC idea and the MOOC platform. And all this has happened at a very short notice. So I think there's been a lot of trepidation on our part and probably on your part also. But we have probably come out of that after these 3 days. But I still have a few concerns which I would like to mention here. And these concerns are out of the observations in the last couple of days. I find that most of us are overwhelmed by the technicalities of the platform itself. And my own view is that we should not be worried about this and leave this to more competent people who have the technical finesse to do these things. So that's my appeal to all of you. It's not just an observation, it's my appeal to all of you. And we should rather concentrate on how best we are going to improve the content of these courses. Yeah. Taking into account the fact that this is a completely different medium, a medium that we are not used to, a medium that has many strengths and probably many weaknesses, or perhaps some weaknesses, we don't know yet. But let us be aware of this difference from normal classroom transaction. And let us concentrate more on improving the quality of our slated courses and leave the technical details to people who are more able. If I were to draw a plan for myself, and my institution is what I mean, I would focus primarily on getting the outline of the course in a good shape in as short a time as possible. And as you say, believe that the technical details will be taken care of somehow in the desired time. So with that note, I would stop once again by thanking the entire team and wishing all of us good times ahead.
Yes, we do wish. We do need good luck, all of us, we need. I just had one suggestion. I was just talking to Professor Pradeep Verma. We have this notion for sponsored projects to have a principal investigator and to have co-PIs. Now, whenever we have done projects with other institutions, for example, I am PI of a project or Professor Kannan is PI of a project, there are co-PIs in the partner institution. Would it make sense if we decided that the coordinators from each institution should be named as co-PIs, because then that will, in my humble opinion, give them a little bit of a nomenclature authority at least, that if they are co-PIs, then they are not only governed by the processes of their universities, but they are also accountable to MHRD as being in charge of these projects from their side.
Sir, I really congratulate you and the team. We have not only learned the things, but also experienced the IIT system and the way it works, and it strongly gave us a message that's very enriching. I have a couple of questions which are maybe different. One is the verified certificates, which may not come now, later. I mean, after your letter after letter coming and things are unfolding, we have get to see things. So suddenly I saw this verified certificate thing. I a bit demoralized in terms of the free access of education and the philosophy behind it. Well, the sustainable idea of it, maybe for a private organizations like our mission, I mean, I our mission is towards a free education. This is one thing. And anyway, without money, we can even give the verified certificate. And the other thing is about the courses which are to be offered can be, I mean, or must be, what I understood, what we are teaching. In that, what is more, I mean, interesting for me is whatever the rigor, whatever the content that we are teaching should be there. But some courses, if we prepare, maybe from, say, we have animation, we have development communication, we have photography, we have mass communication. If we take 2-3 modules and we are taking a course, something like a common course, which actually every student is interested, and these modules are actually taught. I mean to say that by very much, I understand the idea behind it, like accessing the same professor of IIT or MCRC, by, I mean, many people will be interested to look at. But by restricting it exactly the courses which we are offering, papers to be presented there, this I felt kind of a restriction. We will put the same rigor, we'll put the same content, we'll put the same kind of assignments. This is what I would like to say. Some kind of a, I felt a little bit of thing. And sometimes we can even start something innovative, which our own students, which are studying in the first semester, third semester, fourth semester, are interested to join. And that will be enriching for them. And that is again on the way. It is new, it is free for these students, for other students, and for other departments in the same university. This is one, sir. The other things, I think this workshop would have been also included a half-day lectures on the content, like what he was referring, IPRs, Creative Commons, and all these things, and even something like plagiarism. These things would have been added to the those who are, I mean, we're all going to guide lead faculties or other things, which that would have been an enriching aspect of it. My last suggestion, that I don't know how it is viable, like each, since it is going globally, certain things, like if it is a mechanical engineering course or a mathematic course, maybe you may not be having much of, like professor is telling about, we are, our courses are accessed across the cultures, which may give two different meanings. It is not, it is very much possible in social sciences. So in this aspect, we need to establish a kind of a body within the university or a centrally, or maybe at whatever level, to screen the content before it goes out. Or it can be a subject-wise expert committee, something like we have a nodal body wherever whoever makes in, say, mass communication, let us send it, let us review it, we will give a feedback. It would be an expert, I mean, we can assure more, better quality in terms of the examples. This is what, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think there are some questions that are of common concern, so let me answer some of these questions very quickly. First of all, the certificate that you talk about, the verified certificate portion we're not doing. Because verified certificate in the current sense globally means that every student will have to have a webcam enabled machine for every interaction he or she does, which is not possible, will be actually discouraging students from it. We are giving honor code certificate, and that honor code certificate will be based on the evaluation that you do for your course, based on how many exams, quizzes, etc., marks, and that is being given free of cost. There is no charge that is being applied for that. However, in the long term, the principle is that if a student seeks knowledge, it is free. So there is absolutely no problem for any student of India to register for an audit course and go away. If a student requires interaction, then that interaction requires time from faculty and some team. Now that faculty and that time of the TA team is currently being met by government grants. The government is planning to spend huge amount of money just for this experiment for next 3 years. It cannot be perpetuated. There has to be an ecosystem which will take care of it. We have recommended that when the body like a not-for-profit company will do it, it will not do it for profit. But it will have to recover the cost it incurs, and there will be a huge cross-subsidy. A course which is taken by 1 lakh students, and if I have an interaction charge of 300 rupees, then that course alone will earn 3 crore rupees. My cost of creating that course has been 20 lakh rupees. My cost of running that course for 1 lakh students is another 20 lakh rupees for the TA team, and maybe another 10 to 15 lakhs for the actual infrastructure usage, bandwidth usage. There is a huge extra money that is generated. This the Section 8 company will utilize to cross-subsidize running of smaller but important critical courses, and increasing the number of courses, increasing the number of faculty. So there has to be a revenue model for a realistic run. Finally, the credit recognition by a university is like a student who is enrolled in the university for a degree. The student pays fees to the university. That you and I don't think is wrong. All we are saying is the student will similarly pay a fees if the credits are recognized by that university. And that fees also we are recommending should be of the order of 750 to 1000 rupees. And we have done some survey, we will do more survey when the students come, but you would agree that 1000 rupees fees for my credits to be recognized by my university is not uncommon. There also we are saying that that university which accepts this recognition, we will say, since you are not conducting the examination for that student on this subject, the examination fees that you collect from that student should be paid towards this. So these are some of the early thoughts. Of course, the larger issues will emerge, but you are absolutely right, we are all committed. So I will say, giving best quality education in the most affordable fashion, not free, but in most affordable fashion. I will also tell you something, sir, that if you give something free, people do not value it much. If they have paid even 5 rupees, they will value it better. This is the human psychological psychology global. So I will close there. But currently there is no charge for anything. Honor certificate will be made free of. For innovative course content, of course it is true, and let me tell you what the current thinking is of most of the senior educators across the world who are much more advanced in using these MOOCs. They have much more data and feedback. The general opinion is that the conventional papers, which are one semester long or 1 year long, and with collection of so many papers constituting a degree, is going to disappear very fast from the entire higher education system in the world. Packaged modules, which will do a certain thing, and a sequence of multiple modules defined across disciplines will constitute the future degrees. Berkeley and Stanford are experimenting with this right now as we speak, where a conventional BS degree in engineering, which used to be given after 4 years of study as per this syllabus, etc., etc., is now being offered by doing certain basic credits from science, certain basic credits from this, certain basic credits from something else, and these basic credits can now be done through MOOC modules, which are not one semester courses, but which are 1 month long courses. The training, all kinds of vocational training that we can think of, need not at all be a regular course. As I mentioned, a course in animation does not exist as a normal degree course today. But we are recommending it because it helps vocational kind of. Now all this will happen. Currently, however, the scheme that is approved by the government of India is to experiment with the best available signature courses from the well-known universities, which are currently learned by students across different universities. So this scheme has a limited objective, and that is the reason why we are here talking about these courses. But there is enough leeway. Just as we just took a decision that we will have this animation course, any one of you or other members who will come, suppose somebody comes, as you say, innovatively, I have a 4-week course, it is not part of my university syllabus, but I believe that it will have tremendous value. Now, if in the judgment of many others, that has tremendous value, as long as IIT Bombay runs this program, that course will run. Because that is the freedom given to us to run programs like. But it cannot be the case that all universities will offer only specially designed 1-week programs only for everyone. That is not the objective. That is the second point. IPR, I think we already mentioned, and Professor Pradeep Verma has clarified this. We are, again, the scheme does not talk of global presence. In fact, you will notice that in the registration page, you are required to give your PIN code and state and town. The government of India is very clear, while they would very much like learners all over the world to learn, but this scheme is being funded by government of India primarily for learners in India. The government is not insisting that the person must be a student, but it is aimed at students. However, any professional, any person without a job, anybody who has never studied in a college wishes to do a course, as long as the person is Indian from India, permitted to do. The scheme again defines the scope. It is not meant for the global student. But nothing prevents us from, yeah.
Will you do an IP address check and find the geography? I mean, there is a guy from Turkey who writes Maharashtra and Pune and all.
Yes.
Will you do an IP address check and
find? It is, they means only we have to do it. Yeah. We will try and do that, but doubtful. People can create a fake IP address which is 10 dot something, and the fellow may still be in Turkey.
Even though we are asked for that PIN code and all, if there is a Turkish PIN code in this example, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Privately aiming at it.
Yeah, that's right. Actually, by aiming it to the students who are registered normally for similar courses, we are effectively saying that, look, it is primarily meant for us. However, if you are interested, then you are welcome to.
Another suggestion, which was that, you know, when we create a content for courses like art or other thing, aesthetics and other thing, or maybe we quote example in economics and other thing, something which is very normal for me to say would not be taken in that spirit in some part of the country, it's possible, even the color, whatever we, a Christian bride wearing white is good on that day, but an Indian bride doesn't wear white on the wedding, UP bride or something. So there is a lot of difference, things are perceived by people. And because we want to avoid any controversy, I think somebody who is some kind of experience in looking at these, I can volunteer myself. Anybody else can join and see this on a very superficial level, that it does not cause those controversy, the cartoon controversy or this controversy or that controversy, which need to be vetted. It's important.
Yeah, I think another similar point was earlier also made. I think we have not yet put in place, or we don't intend to put in place, a precaution of this kind. But it would be very useful if this consortium creates a body of people with expertise in different domains who could advise the project execution by IIT Bombay by offering to help in vetting such contents from this point of view. It had not occurred to us. So I think we'll add in our initial request itself, that when you create a course, apart from other things, please keep in mind the following thing and get them reviewed and probably certify that our contents do not, our contents avoid touching sensitivities across, because India also is a multicultural thing, you know, multi-ethnic. That's a very good point.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah.
So suppose some course is launched today and runs for the next 4 months. Now the person who has created this course and has run this course for 4 months decides next year or 6 months down the line that he is no longer interested.
Yes.
What happens to this content?
Nothing. That course remains. The course is in open source. Please understand that when we say open source, we are open sourcing the content of the course, but not the quizzes and the question banks.
Okay, so the quizzes and the question banks.
That's right, they remain.
They remain.
But they are there on
the
platform.
But they are not used by the
now,
participants.
Now, the consortium must make its level-based efforts to find out if there is any other teacher who is willing to run that course.
Using
maybe
the
by
old
modifying it or using his own TAs or something like that. That is the reason why I have insisted on a separate budget for running a course as opposed to creating a course.
Okay. So the same
as I said, if Professor Gadre takes Nirvana after 2 years, and suppose by that time I have picked up interest in signals and systems, and I say, I will run this course. But you see, the major job of intellectual contribution he has done. I still have to do the job of deciphering the generated questions on the discussion forum, answering them, and maybe adding a few more videos, etc. But that is always a danger. In fact, that is the question when I had made the presentation in that international conference on blended MOOCs, and everybody clapped. And I asked them this question, that when blended MOOC course is offered, let's say by ICER offers that Physics 101, you offer that, and 2 years it runs, and Visveshwara University of Karnataka takes it, saying that is the standard course. So 200 engineering colleges, all students take that course. Now third year you take Nirvana. The course is no more running, but the students need that course because that is part of their degree program. See, one thing we don't realize, the significance and importance of a university system or an institution system. In IIT Bombay, for example, no matter whether a teacher who is teaching this course is available or not, a course will run. It has been approved by the Senate. It is a part of a degree program. It is the responsibility of IIT Bombay to run that course. Same thing in Delhi University or any university. If a BA program is announced, then all papers must run. That is the responsibility of the university. MOOCs mein aisa nahi hai. I might next year say this, thank you. Nahi chahiye, I don't want money. I don't know anything, but is enough. So there is a real danger, and that is why for perpetuating the usage of such courses, it is very important that the course be created not only with an angle of creating the best course, but ensuring that anybody can run that course later. In fact, this is something that Supratik and I are specifically looking at, that the CS101 course that we create should be run by any professor of computer science. It should be so delineated. This is another aspect you might want to keep in mind while you create a course. So it's a difficult decision, because on one hand, you want the best teacher to bring out the best in that course. Now clearly that teacher teaches differently from me and others. That is why the teacher is best. But can that best teacher capture the essence of his or her expertise in such a way that anybody else can facilitate running that course? That is the challenge. We'll answer these questions as time passes by. I think it is good that we are raising these questions. The point is, we have not a river to swim across, we have an ocean to swim across. And we can't keep standing on the kinara and keep saying, ki, are yaar, pani bahut thanda hai, kya karenge? Kudte hain, dekhte hain, aage kya hota hai? Aage, upar wala malik.
Sir, this is not a question, just Haan. Some information about CS101.
Haan.
You said there are 60,000 students,
yeah.
They register, then maybe some 25,000-30,000 they continue, and ultimately maybe slightly lesser than they pass 10,000, out.
Right.
So do we have some statistics, what are their login patterns, like weekends, nights,
we will
days,
get we will get that data at the end of the course.
Oh, okay.
Okay. That also I would like to tell you, that when your course runs, then you are entitled to get the entire data for that course, including information about students, etc. It's just like any class. But our self-imposed privacy laws prohibit exchanging any data for one's course with any other institute or any other teacher. The global practice is that they are trying anonymizing algorithms. So they anonymize data for the purposes of statistical analysis will be made available. I am going to attend the EDX conference where they will shed more light on how they are anonymizing it. We will adopt those algorithms and we will also create the anonymized data. But the data belongs to the faculty member and university which runs a course. Now at the end of the course, as per the current available software, the entire interaction data which is created is given out to you. In fact, there is a nomenclature which EDX uses, which is called data czar. Czar as in the czar of Russia. So each university has to have a data czar. We have Shweta, who is our data czar. She is a sysadmin. Data czar means she is the only person who will be given access to data by the EDX global. Now it is her responsibility to ensure that if it is Professor Vikram Gadre's course data, he and his research team of analytics have access to it. My course or Supratik's course, we have it. We may internally collaborate to work on the, let's say, large Hadoop platform to do common analytics or something like that. But that is the discipline that is. So thank you very much. I think we are delayed by almost half an hour for the closing session.